It's been so long, oh, such a long time since I've lived with peace and rest. Now I am here, my destination, and I guess things work for the best. And I know Jesus, when you ran your kingdom, could you please, please remember.
Mountain maker, ocean tamer, glimpses of you burn in my eyes. The worship of heaven fills up the skies. You made it all, said let there be. Creator, wind breather,
and the countdown is all wrapped up, so there's nothing to prevent us from going forward now. It's good to have all of you here this morning. We look forward to celebrating communion here, as we do every week. If you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you can look forward to celebrating communion with us midway through the service. Also, we're going to be collecting an offering, and we have black boxes up here. That'll be midway through the service. If you're a guest this morning, we do not ask that you put anything in the offering except perhaps contact information from this green card. You'll find one of those nearby, and hopefully a writing utensil as well, so you can get that slipped in. This is the time of year when we have a pile of announcements, so I'm going to try to go through them in order of increasing, not urgency, but chronological of the future. So coming up next week, Sunday the 14th, this will be your last chance to bring in those shoeboxes. They are starting to pile up already. In years past, sometimes we've set the goal around 50 or 60, and then every once in a while we'll hit like a year there's 80, and we think, oh, well, we better set the goal for 50 next year because we can't count on hitting 80. But if we did, that'd be great. So everybody work hard on collecting the empties out there and then returning them full next week. That would be excellent so they can get shipped around the world to the kiddos who most need them. The week after that, that'll be 2 weeks from today, the Women's Study will make another attempt. Their October gathering was delayed, but hopefully in 2 weeks they'll be able to gather again after church. Well, maybe not out there. I'm sure in late November we'll be in here. Not we metaphorically, the ladies will be in here enjoying their lunch and going over the second member of the Trinity. Through the rest of November, that's three more Sundays, you can bring in diapers for the Ellsworths. They're having their third kiddo coming up imminently. Put the diapers out there so we can be blessing them as they will surely need them. And then December 5th will be a busy, busy day. It always seems to land this way frequently, that on December the 5th, we'll have a congregational meeting after church to go over the budget for the next year. We'll do a review of the year past and the giving and the expenses, take a look at the year to come. That budget will be on the website. As soon as I put it on the website, you'll have plenty of time to review that under the resources page and then hear Craig talk about it for about 20 minutes after church. And then we'll have a report from the staff as well. Those never last longer than about 50 minutes and sometimes not even that. So that's coming up on the 5th of December. And then in the evening, Northview is the church. Northview doesn't want us. North Ridge wants us to come and sing songs. I'm sure Northview would take us, but we'll take theirs more gladly. North Ridge is the retirement center up the road, and we'll be doing caroling there the evening of December the 5th. I believe that'll be at 5 p.m. Policies there for now are that visitors are welcome if they're masked. So that'll be the plan, and then we'll come back here for our Christmas dinner. So from 10 a.m. to deep into the evening, that'll be quite a day for Prairie View. Now, this is the first Sunday in November, so it's a joke around the elder table that anytime somebody says, well, this is the time of year when we celebrate whatever, somebody says, it's always that time of year because of Craig Hunter and Craig being the silly husband that he is. It's always Valentine's Day in the Hunter household. It's become this silly elder in-joke, but Hallmark decreed that October is Pastor Appreciation Month, but hopefully every month is Pastor Appreciation Month at Prairie View. So now that we are into November, we can encourage you to continue to encourage the pastors in the work that they do here, Ben and Zach and Mark, and don't neglect Nancy as well. She's one of the beloved staff members, the longest tenured staff member. All right, now that takes us to our scripture. Last week, we finished our 8th out of 11 weeks in John, looking at the truly, truly statements. All the sermons are always online, and the videos are now too. If you missed it last week, it was basically Ben inserting himself into the upper room and saying, show me the glory, because it didn't seem like there was much yet. He'll be continuing with that in John 14, and a passage that goes with that comes from Philippians chapter 2, starting in verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, not something to cling to, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's approach this God the Father in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that we can come to you. Thank you that because Jesus was not content to stay in glory, to stay in heaven, but was willing to come here and subject himself to mortality, and very ignominious one at that. Thank you that we can be brought back into your presence and brought back into a state of rightness with you. And thank you that Jesus was willing to not just go through some sort of motions, but actually paid for our sins. Thank you that the breach that separated us from you was paid for at the cross for each of your people. And thank you that we can remember that every every Friday is Good Friday and every Sunday is Easter Sunday at Prairie View. And thank you that we can be reminded of what you have done for us, not just through the communion that we celebrate midway through the service, but the songs that we sing beforehand and the way that we open your word after it. And I pray that the way that you have brought life into our lives through Jesus Christ will be growing in increasing obviousness as we grow in you throughout the way that we live our lives during the week. Thank you that it's a time of year when we can be cultivating intentionally gratitude and then celebrating the coming of your son, Jesus. But pray that whether it's an up week or a down week, a normal day or a different kind of day, that we can be pursuing more and more closely after you. And thank you that you've given us churches to help each other with that. And thank you for all the visitors that are here this morning. Pray that we can help them feel welcome, but most importantly, help them see you. It's in your great name that we pray. Amen.
Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All this joy is flowing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, 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 your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, 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 your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, 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 your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, your love makes me sing. Your love makes me sing. Your love makes me sing, sing, sing. Your love makes me sing. From beginning to the end, all my life is in your hand. This whole world may hold me down, but it can never drown you out. I'm not merely flesh and bone, I was made for something more. You are God, you're the great I, the breath of life I breathe you in. Even in the fight, I'm alive in you. You are strong in my brokenness, sovereign over every step. Even in the fight, I'm alive. dark, I hear your voice. Rising up, I will rejoice. For I was lost, but now I'm found. 'Cause even death can't hold you down. You are God, you're the great I am. Breath of life, I breathe you in. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. You're strong in my brokenness, 'cause I've been over every step. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. Christ who lives within me. From beginning to the end, you deserve the glory. You deserve the glory. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives within me. Christ who lives within me. From beginning to the end, you deserve the glory. The glory. You are God, you're the great I am. Breath of life, I breathe you in. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. You are strong in my brokenness, sovereign over every step. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. You are God, you're the great I am. Breath of life, I breathe you in. Even in the fire, I'm alive in you. You are strong in my brokenness, sovereign over every step. Even in the fire, I'm alive. I'm alive in you. That saved a wretch like me. Now once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart. Grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secure. He will my shield and portion. As long as life endures, my chains are gone. like soon the sun for there to shine. But God, you call me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. You guys can have a seat.
Well, good morning. It's good to be with you on this stunningly beautiful fall day of November. And my name is Rick Ayton. I'm an elder here, and with that, I have the privilege of leading us into communion and offering. But before I do that, one item of administration. The announcements of the congregational singing at Northridge will actually take place at 5:45 instead of 5 o'clock. And the meal will be at 6:30. Linda told me that if you show up here at 6:15 that you're going to be hungry for a while. So it's in the bulletin. That's correct. So just a note there. So after a meditation, you're going to be invited to come up and take the elements, the bread and the juice, and take them back to your seats to meditate for a few minutes and eat and drink at your own time. And offering, there's the two black boxes for offering, and we invite you to drop your offering there. If you're a visitor, we do not expect you to give. However, you're welcome to partake in that item of worship with us. 12 years ago, on this very weekend of November 2009, our oldest daughter, Chelsea, was a member of Team USA as they competed in the Synchronized Swimming World Cup Championships in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. And I was the parent in our household that was fortunate enough to be able to travel and attend the competition while Linda stayed back and made sure our other daughter went to school and went to practice and did all those other things. Team USA did not medal, but they finished fourth, ahead of many countries, but behind Canada, Russia, and Spain. The team overachieved based on their expectations, so after the final night of competition, it was a festive atmosphere of celebration, of photos, and congratulations all around. Normally at these competitions all weekend, the young ladies are sequestered at their hotel or in the pool, away from everybody. And on this final night of competition, the coaches allowed the kids to ride back to the hotel with their parents. So after the celebration had died down and the natatorium was almost empty, Chelsea and I set out for my rental car on level 5 of the parking garage. Now, Montreal was the site of the 1976 Summer Olympics, and the swimming competition was at the Olympic Natatorium next to this gigantic, massive, underground, 5-level parking garage. And earlier in 2009, Chelsea was a member of Junior Team USA, who competed in the Junior Pan Am Games. And after returning home in July, she was then asked to participate with Team USA, and from July through November, flew down to San Antonio every other week to train. So now the wear and tear of training was getting the best of her by the end of this weekend, and whenever she wasn't in the water, she was hobbling around on crutches with a suspected torn meniscus. So as we entered the parking garage, we set upon a hike completely across this half-mile-wide garage on level 5. We were carrying her large athlete bag, and I was trying to help Chelsea hobble to my rental car. And as we got almost to the corner, I realized that the one car remaining on that level 5 parking garage was not my rental car. So feeling terrible, I didn't know what to do. I didn't want her to walk all the way back and walk up to the level 4, which I had now remembered is where I parked the car. So I just told her to just stay right here. So she's standing in the middle of this huge garage. And so I ran across the garage to the stairway. I didn't want to wait to the elevator. I ran upstairs to level 4. I ran completely across the garage to my rental car, and I made my way over to the cylindrical ramp to go down to level 5 when I encountered my first problem. You could only go up. So I went up and up and up and up around and around, and as I exited, I was directed onto this large boulevard that wound around the entire Olympic Village, 2 or 3 miles, till I finally came to an intersection onto an expressway where I could see ahead of me that there was a red light. starting to panic now, because now it had been over 10 minutes, maybe 15 minutes by now. I gave myself permission to turn right on red in Canada, even though I didn't know if it was legal. But then there was another problem, because the sign to the parking garage pointed left. And so after waiting for several minutes for traffic to clear, I decided it was legal in Canada to turn left on red. And so left I turned and down the expressway to the entrance to the garage. And since now I was gone almost 15 minutes, I tried to call Chelsea real quickly, but I got nothing but voicemail. And I came to the entrance of the garage, and by this time it was closed, and there was a gate. So now that the statute of limitations has expired, and I'm not going to tell you exactly how I got in, but I got creative very quickly, and I was able to get my small little compact rental around the gate, and down the cylindrical exit thing I went, squealing tires, as I was going down to level 5. And my thoughts were centered on just getting to Chelsea. Was she okay? I had left her completely exposed from a location standpoint to anyone that could do her harm. So I entered level 5 and zoomed to the center of it, but Chelsea was nowhere to be found. She wasn't there. So I called her again, and I got voicemail. I ran into the natatorium, but I couldn't find her. I ran downstairs to the locker room. Maybe she went in there. I found a security guard, and she went in and searched the locker room without success. I ran back to my car, another call and voicemail. I was frantic. What had I allowed to happen on my watch? At this point, my only aim in life was to find my daughter safe. I raced out of the parking garage while wondering, does Canada have a 911? Do I call the city police, the provincial police? What will I do? What will my wife say that I lost my daughter? Upon my exit of the parking garage, I tried one more call to Chelsea, and this time there was a click. There was an answer. And you all know in those phone calls, there's that millisecond where you wondered what the first tone will be. Will she be frantic? Is she safe? Will she be anxious? Will she be mad at me for leaving her? But then I heard this lighthearted, "Hi, Daddy." And to make a long story short, shortly after I'd left her in the middle of this concrete cave, another family drove by and offered to give her a ride back to the hotel, and she gladly accepted. And of course, she called me and left a voicemail, but I never got that because of the parking garage being this concrete cave where we had no reception. And I know you've all had situations where just frantic, chasing something. And when I read scripture, the Bible, I feel God is frantic and anxious for us to come to him through his son Jesus, to be reconciled, to save his relationship back to him. He loves us and seeks our faith and knocks on the door of our heart. In this sermon series in John, I was reminded of my lost daughter story from 2009. In John chapter 12, starting in verse 27, Jesus says, "Father, bring glory to your name." Then a voice spoke from heaven saying, "I have already brought it glory and will do it again." When the crowd heard the voice, some thought it was thunder, while others declared an angel had spoken to him. Then Jesus told them, "The voice was for your benefit, not mine. The time of judgment for the world has come, when the prince of this world will be cast out, and when I am lifted up on the cross, I will draw everyone to myself." And so Jesus draws us to communion, to the communion table every week to remember God's love for us and the sacrifice that he made on the cross. Jesus died an awful death so we could live in his spirit, yet we die too, but we die with the eternal promise of time in heaven with our Creator God. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I know what it's like to feel like you lose something and to be frantic and to be anxious, and I know that you're that way with us. And you sent your Son, who was fully human and fully God, and so therefore it was even you, I feel like, that died on the cross, even though it was Jesus, our Savior. Father, thank you for just accepting the burden of our sin and reconciling us back to you for all of us who choose to believe Jesus is our Savior, our Lord. Father, be with us as we come forward to the table and take the bread, which represents the broken body, and the juice, which represents the blood that he shed on our behalf on the cross. It's in our Son's name that we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning again. Welcome to Prairie View Christian Church. Thanks for being here today. So last week, we shifted from the first half of John's Gospel, which is often called the Book of Signs, to the second half, often called the Book of Glory. But let's be honest. What we read from John 13 wasn't all that glorious. It started with Jesus washing the disciples' feet, a humiliating form of service. Then we read that Jesus would be betrayed by one of his own disciples, Judas. And then last, Jesus predicted that Peter, seemingly the most loyal disciple of them all, would deny him three times. There doesn't seem to be anything glorious about washing feet, being betrayed, and being denied. So the only way John 13 can be construed as glorious is if we turn our understanding of glory upside down. But then again, the gospel of a crucified Lord does just that. So John 13 seemed to contain a lot of bad news, and Jesus recognizes that. That's why he says in verse 1 of chapter 14, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me." In the rest of this chapter, Jesus gives his understandably disturbed disciples some good news. And thankfully, John 14 is not just good news for Jesus' followers back then. It's good news for Jesus' followers right now. So open up to John chapter 14, verse 1. Feel free to follow along as we go in our Bibles, which you can take home if you don't have one, or follow along on the screen. But before we go further, let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this time that we have together to worship you. Lord, thank you that you are unchanging, that you are so good and so perfect and so glorious in and of yourself. And even as so much around us changes, maybe in good ways with the changing of the seasons and the beautiful colors, and maybe in bad ways when things seem to go wrong, thank you that you do not change. You don't change because you don't need to change. You don't need to get any better than you already are, than you always have been. And so, Lord, as we think about that and try to wrap our minds around your greatness, I pray that would drive us to worship, drive us to awe, drive us to praise. And Lord, thank you that we know you. Thank you that you've revealed yourself to us, especially in your word. And I pray that you would be with us this morning as we read your word. Your word is not just a religious document. This is not just an interesting text worthy of study or admiration, but this is your revelation of yourself. The way we know you, the primary way we know you, is by reading your word. And so help us enter into your word with gratitude and with humility and with open hearts and open minds. So Lord, thank you again for this opportunity to worship together, to consider who you are, to read your word and learn more about who you are. Lord, I pray that we would respond rightly to who you are with the way we worship you this morning. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Well, starting in John chapter 14, verse 1, Jesus says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." So in these verses, Jesus gives his anxious disciples three main pieces of good news. First, Jesus promises them that one day they will be with him again. That's verses 1 through 4. Jesus had told the disciples back in chapter 13 that he was going away. In verse 33, he said he was going somewhere that they cannot come. And that troubled Peter enough that he asked Jesus about it in verse 36. "Lord, why can't I go with you now? I'll lay my life down for you." But in chapter 14, Jesus promises Peter and the rest of the disciples and you and me that though he is in a sense gone now, one day we will be with him. This is a promise of eternal reward, a heavenly dwelling with God for those who believe in and obey Jesus. There have often been misunderstandings about heaven amongst Christians. We sometimes view heaven as a disembodied existence far off in the sky. Picture people sitting on clouds eating cream cheese. Sometimes we view heaven as nothing more than a better version of earth, a place where we get to eat our favorite food every day, spend all our time on our hobbies, and no longer have those achy joints. But at the end of the day, what makes heaven heaven is God's presence. Heaven is where God is. And Jesus promises his disciples that one day we will be in God's presence. One day we'll be resurrected, as Jesus is resurrected, in a new heaven and a new earth. God will dwell with us, and we will dwell with him as it was always meant to be. That's good news. Now, the second piece of good news, verses 5 through 11, is that Jesus points the way to God's presence. It's true that the disciples needed some help figuring it out, but thankfully, the answer is literally standing right in front of them. There's only one way to the Father, Jesus Christ, God's Son. As we've seen throughout this gospel, God the Father and God the Son are a package deal. Now, John 14:6 may not be a popular verse in a pluralistic, all-inclusive society. But in the words of Daryl Bach, no text in Scripture is clearer than this one in stating that access to God is given only through Christ. Access to God is given only through Christ. So there's only one way to God's presence, and that's good news. Now, what makes that good news, you might ask? Because you know it. Because I know it. And if you didn't know it when you walked in here this morning, you do now. The third piece of good news is the privilege of prayer. Verses 13 and 14 tell us that whatever we ask in Jesus' name, in accordance with God's glory, of course, God will do it. That's not a guaranteed answer to every prayer. Tacking the phrase "in Jesus' name" onto the end of every prayer is not a magic guarantee that God will do what we ask. God will do what is best, and he knows what that is better than we do. As Jesus says in Matthew 6:8, right before he gives us the Lord's Prayer, God knows what we need before we even ask. So while these words are not a guaranteed yes to every prayer request, they should encourage us to pray in Jesus' name with boldness and with confidence. Now, before we move forward, what do you do with that truly, truly statement in verse 12? How in the world can we, as Jesus' disciples, do greater works than Jesus? I don't know about you, but I haven't raised anybody from the dead lately. And if you have, feel free to share that with the group. This isn't so much about the spectacle of the works, how amazing this one act really is. It's more about the context in which we serve. In a sense, Jesus' greatness is more obvious now than it was when he spoke those words in verse 12. Why? How? Because Jesus is now crucified, resurrected, and ascended. Thus, in a way, the works that we do now in Jesus' name are even greater than they were before. Because the Lord who we serve's greatness is more evident now than it ever has been. Now, so far, so good, right? John 14 already seems much more optimistic and much more glorious than John 13 did. We have these three pieces of good news so far: the promise of God's presence, knowledge of the way to get there, and the privilege of prayer as we wait. But, in the words of theologian Billy Mays, Bishop of OxyClean, but wait, there's more. John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. In that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." Judas, not Iscariot, imagine being that guy. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, "Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus answered him, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. And the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced, because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here. So we have two more pieces of good news in these verses. The fourth bit from John 14 is the presence of the Holy Spirit, verses 15 through 26. As we said earlier, in a sense, Jesus is leaving. Even now, he's not with us in the same way that he was with the disciples. But in another sense, thanks to the presence of the Holy Spirit, Jesus is closer to his people now than ever. Jesus calls the Holy Spirit the Helper. Other translations say the Advocate, the Counselor, the Comforter. One even says legal assistant. The Spirit helps us remember Jesus' words. Verse 26. In chapters 15 and 16, Jesus says the Spirit will help us bear witness about him, will give us courage, will give us the words to say. The Spirit will convict the world of sin, convict the world of righteousness, and guide us into truth. That's all good news. As we saw earlier, one day Jesus will return. He will be physically present with his disciples once again, and that day will be awesome. But in the meantime, he has not left us as orphans. While we wait, we have the Holy Spirit living within us. And he, yes, he, not it, can help us press on in faith until Jesus comes. Now, the fifth and final piece of good news from this chapter, one that's easy to overlook, comes in verse 30. The devil is no match for Jesus. Last week, we read that the devil entered into Judas Iscariot's heart and spurred on his act of betrayal. And according to verse 30, this same devil is coming for Jesus. What Judas was doing, Jesus told him to do quickly. The words that we're reading are essentially part of one long conversation leading up to Jesus' arrest. His time is at hand. But look at what Jesus says at the end of verse 30. The devil has no claim on him. He has no claim on him. Satan is a real danger to God's people. He can do us real harm. 1 Peter 5:8 calls the devil a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But we Christians know that while the devil may be stronger than us, he is no match for our Lord. You may see on social media sometimes those pictures going around of Jesus and the devil locked in an arm wrestling match. And it says, share this photo or the devil wins. Well, I can assure you that your social media activity has no impact on Jesus' overcoming of Satan. If you want to share it, but it's not doing anything. But I will also say of that picture, that image of Jesus and the devil locked in arm wrestling, and oh my gosh, who's going to win? They both have big veins, and they both have big biceps. It looks like a pretty good matchup. It's not. It's not a good matchup. Scripture makes that clear. The devil has no claim on Jesus. He has no shot against Jesus. And because he has no claim on Jesus, He has no final claim on us. And that is good news. So altogether, we have five pieces of good news for Jesus' stressed out disciples. Though he's leaving now, Jesus promises that they will be with him again. Jesus has pointed out the only way to the Father. You're looking at him. Jesus has held out the privilege of prayer in his name. He's told them of the coming presence of the Holy Spirit, and he's pronounced the devil's defeat. Again, this isn't just good news for the disciples back then. It's good news for disciples like you and me today. But there's one final point to consider. How do we know for sure that all this good news of John 14 is ours? Well, if you didn't notice, there's been a big emphasis throughout this chapter on the disciples' faith and obedience. The disciples have been consistently reminded, challenged, and encouraged to do what the old hymn tells us to do, to trust and obey. Now, where do we see the emphasis on the first one? Trust, faith. John 14, verse 1, believe in God, believe also in me. In verses 10 through 12, the word believe occurs four times in three verses. It's kind of important. And then verse 29, I've told you before it takes place so that when it does take place, you may believe. It's a big emphasis in John. It's a big emphasis in this chapter. Now, where do we see the other side? Obedience. Verse 12, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. Verse 15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Verse 21, whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. Verses 23 and 24, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Whoever does not love me does not keep my word. So how do we know that all this good news of John 14 really is ours? Well, to put it simply, we trust and obey Jesus. Don't fall into the trap of setting faith and obedience against each other. There's an extreme camp that Christians are sometimes tempted to fall into. It's the camp that says, well, as long as I believe, as long as I raised a hand, said a prayer, got baptized, maybe signed a card, it doesn't really matter what I do. I believe. That's placing all the emphasis on trust at the expense of obey. The other extreme is basically the opposite. Well, you don't necessarily have to believe all this stuff, as long as you do the same kind of stuff that Jesus did. As long as you love people, as long as you're kind, as long as you're generous, as long as you're hospitable, who really cares what you believe? Well, John 14, 6 might have something to say about that. That's placing all the emphasis on obey at the expense of trust. As James famously said, faith without works is dead. Conversely, works without faith are dead too. John 14 does not separate our faith in Jesus from our obedience to Jesus. And neither should we. So may we both believe in Jesus and follow Jesus and prove ourselves to be his disciples. May we take all the good, glorious news of John 14 and apply it to our hearts, our minds, and our lives. May we trust and obey. We'll end this morning with the words that Jesus started the chapter with. Let not your hearts be troubled. There's all kinds of troubling stuff in the world today. Cultural chaos, political upheaval, economic uncertainty, and seemingly unending threats to our physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual well-being. The world we live in is just as fallen as ever. And as a result, even the most mature disciple of Jesus can understandably feel intimidated and overwhelmed. But let not your hearts be troubled. The good news of John 14 is just as true for you as it was for Peter and the rest of the disciples. We too have the eternal reward of being in God's presence laying ahead of us. And Jesus has pointed out and provided the way there through his own death and resurrection. We too have the privilege of praying in Jesus' name. We too have the Holy Spirit living powerfully within us, and we too have a promise that the devil has no claim on our Lord and has no claim on us either. So may we too be at peace. May we too not be afraid. Let not your hearts be troubled. Rather, may we simply, faithfully, and joyfully trust and obey. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for this day. Thank you for this word that you've given us. Thank you for the Gospel of John. Thank you for this artist's portrait of who you are and what you have done in your incarnation, in your life, in your death, in your resurrection. And Lord, I pray that as we follow you now, as we live as your disciples, almost 2,000 years removed from when these words were first spoken, I pray that the good news that John 14 contained for those original disciples, that we would recognize what good news it is for us as well. So Lord, I pray that you would strengthen us and enable us and empower us to trust and obey, to really believe all these promises, and to respond accordingly, not just in our heads, not just with our words, but with our lives and our deeds. Lord, help us follow you, help us trust and obey you. And Lord, let not our hearts be troubled. Like we said, there are all kinds of reasons that our hearts could be troubled and often are troubled, but the peace that you give us exceeds whatever might trouble us in this world. And so I pray that you would help us embrace that peace. Remind us that we are not alone, that you haven't left us as orphans, that we're not navigating this fallen world by ourselves, but that you are with us, you will be with us once again. And Lord, help us trust and obey until that day comes. Thank you for the gift of the Spirit. Thank you for the gift of your cross. Thank you for the gift of prayer, that we can say and pray all these things in your name. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing.
The mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good. You are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh, you are good, good, oh, let the king of my heart be the way. beside myself, an anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song, let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. You are You are good, good. Oh, oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let. Never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let me down. The shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, good.
As we close our service, I know you're all hungry, but hey, you get out of service earlier than most churches anyway, so you'll be fine. Let's nerd out for a minute on John chapter 14, verse 28. We didn't spend a lot of time on it, but I just want to give a brief little overview here. That verse says, Jesus speaking, "You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I." Now, you might hear that and think, okay, what's the big deal about John 14, verse 28? Here's the big deal. That last little phrase, "for the Father is greater than I," that has been a big source of debate within the Christian church for roughly 1,800 years. The earliest Christians spent the first couple centuries after Jesus' death and resurrection, trying to figure out what to make of this guy. Is he 51% God and 49% man? Is he 75% God and 25% man? Is it the other way around? Did he just look like he was a man? And he wasn't really a man. He was just God all along. These are the types of conversations that happened early in the history of the church. And thankfully, around the year 325 AD, Christians put their heads together and figured out that, hey, you know what? Jesus is fully God and fully man, and we might not be able to wrap our minds around that, but that's what it is. So, yay, good development. Then the question started arising, okay, well, wait a minute. We have this Trinity, which is not a biblical word, but it's a word that Christians came up with to capture biblical teaching, and it does it quite well. We have this Trinity, Father, Son, Spirit. Well, who's the best? Who's on top? Is there a ranking of who's the greatest? Who's the most powerful? Who's the most important? And the answer is, they're all great. They're all co-equal. They're all co-eternal. The Son is not less God than the Father. The Father is not more God than the Spirit. The Son is not more God than the Spirit, etc. You can go around on all kinds of triangles about this. Now, why am I bringing this up? I know, you're hungry. Verse 28, Jesus says, I'm going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. Some people have taken that verse to say, look at that. We have biblical evidence of God the Father being greater than God the Son. Jesus is a lesser being than God the Father. That's called Arianism. And for about 1,800 years, that has been bad theology. And we as Christians and we as this church, we want to do good theology because good theology matters. So when Jesus says in verse 28, the Father is greater than I, he's speaking in the context of the incarnation. That as Jesus is walking the earth, doing the things that God has given him to do, he is under the Father's authority. He said that throughout the Gospel of John, that he's doing the things the Father tells him to do. So in a sense, yes, in the Gospel of John, Jesus has submitted himself to God's authority. But that is not saying that Jesus is somehow a lesser being than God the Father. Again, that's bad theology, and we don't want to do bad theology at Prairie View Christian Church. So, that's why we talked about verse 28. You're hungry. Let's close our service in prayer. If you have questions about who we are as a church, what we do, what we teach, what we believe, if you want to talk about the Council of Nicaea at 325 AD and Constantine, I would love to have that conversation with you, but now's not the time or place. So, with that, I'll close our service in prayer. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this time that you've given us together to worship you. Thank you for your word. Thank you that you have given us minds to think about it. Thank you that you have given us ears to hear it and eyes to read it. But Lord, most of all, thank you that you have given us this inspired word, inspired by your Spirit, to change our hearts and to change our minds, to overcome the power of sin in our lives and in our hearts and in our minds, and draw us to you and help us be the people you call us to be. So, Lord, I pray that we would do that in the week ahead, that as we go out in this world full of troubles, that our hearts would not be troubled, that we would embrace these gifts that you've given us of John 14 and elsewhere in your word, and live confidently, live boldly, live joyfully, trusting and obeying you regardless of what comes our way. Again, thank you for this opportunity to worship you with these people in this place at this time. I pray that our worship would carry over to the rest of the week and everywhere we go and in everything we do. We love you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Have a great Sunday.
Team.
Thank you
for jumping in. I'm always happy to be here. I'm always down to sing. You'll be hard pressed to find a time when I'm like, nah. Right. I don't want to be on the worship team today. You'll
not
never find
today.
I wonder if they can hear us at home.
there.